Good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
Good evening.
Usual housekeeping thing, you all know where the loos are. If the fire alarm does go off, we'll have to move out the way we came into the car park. And in a real emergency, this is a fire escape here. We can't stay out there if it becomes an emergency. Right, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. Welcome to the Bell Hotel, Thetford, where we meet tonight. In order to try and plan a better way through these strange times that we are all presently enduring. A famous son of this town once stated that these are the times that try men's souls. And those words resonate now in our time just as much as they did when first uttered by Mr. Thomas Paine way back in the 1700s during the American Revolution. Ladies and gentlemen, what is the aim of this evening? The aim of this evening is to set up our Thetford Sovereign Council. A council of ordinary people that will scrutinise, challenge and suggest a better way of doing things in our town. As we said, what we want from the council is we want to be able to suggest, scrutinise and challenge a better way of doing things in our town. We want to suggest a better way of doing things to not only the present elected council, the town council, but also the 76% of people who did not vote in the last local election and who feel abandoned by the major parties and also the political system that they all now operate within. Right, we're all aware then, we've all suffered. We live in a controlled information void at the minute. I think you'd all agree with that, yeah? Mm-hmm. We have cancel culture. People being thrown off social media. YouTube is shadow banning and demonetising people. The television news is controlled and manipulated. All television stations, along with the national newspapers, are controlled by big media corporations. Yeah. That wield more power than our elected representatives. Would you all agree with that?
Yeah.
We're not allowed to watch RT, Russia Today News, as God forbid we would be able to listen as grown-ups and decide for ourselves what is actually happening in some far-off fighting. We all now realise that our duly elected representatives on all levels of council will not fully engage with us. They either limit us to 15-minute periods of questions where nothing can be debated or resolved. They will not allow us to speak at all in some situations. When we do try and speak, they turn off the microphones. And in some cases, they even walk out and abandon the chambers to the public in a frantic hurry to get away from the very people that they are supposedly there to represent. We are now starting to realise that they are not there to represent us and conduct bottom-up decision-making. They are there to enforce top-down plans and initiatives cooped up by the likes of the UN, the WEF and the WHO, filtered down through our national government in contradiction to the wishes of we the people, and they do not operate within the law. Before we go any further, for those some people in the room, what is the law? Okay, some people will know.
What, common law or there's two times, isn't there?
This will lead into why we're doing what we're doing now. What is the law? I mean, I am not an expert, but when we done some of our local courses, we found out this stands for
land, air and water.
Land, for those who don't know, the air and the water. Yeah. Three different types of law. The law of the land is common law, natural law, God's law, spiritual law. The law of the earth is canon law that deals with trusts, anything that goes into a trust. The common law deals with trespass, murder, violence, theft, things like that. The law of the water Property law, the law of the sea, that deals with contracts and corporations. Contracts and corporations. Now, when I just spoke about our governments and the people who represent us, you will find, if you do some research, that those people are all working for a corporation. And they are only there to make money. Corporations are only there to make money. So they are operating under the law of the sea, in the water. This is why when we start asking things at our council level and start asking questions, this is why we're closed down. This is why we're not listened to. This is why we're not allowed to debate with them. Because they are all living in the sea and dealing with contracts and corporations. You're all happy with that. So basically what we have to do, when we understand that, we need to get out of the water and get back onto the land. We need to get back in to the earth. It's the last bit I want to tell you about the law of the land, on the few things that I know about it. We've got the natural God's spiritual law. That's at the top. Every one of us knows what's wrong and right. Everybody on the planet, we all know what's wrong and right. What we can do, what we can't do. We'll call it the natural law. Okay, in our country where we come from, under that comes the common law. Okay, the people live under the common law for what's right and wrong. We don't trespass, we don't thieve, unless you're in Liverpool. We always give it back if you've got less than us, by the way. You know, you don't murder. We all know. So the common law comes under the natural law. Now, under the common law, then, we have the people. The people stand under the common law. The common law is under the natural law. Now, we're all very, very busy. We have things to do, jobs, and we need a few set of basic rules to keep society going. So we elect some people to help out at that level, and we'll call them the representatives. Who would our representatives be? Who would we put in place to represent us?
Councils,
MPs, they're our representatives.
Yep.
Okay, and they work for us, the people. As those representatives come up with a few loose directives to keep us on the straight and narrow, they have a gang of people to help them. The police. You all agree with that? So the police stand under the representatives, MPs and councillors. The MPs and councillors stand under the people. We elect them to work for us. The people stand under the common law, and the common law comes from God's natural spiritual law. So that is the law of the land. That is the help. Everybody happy with that? Okay, what's going wrong at the minute? Anybody? What is going wrong?
It's upside down.
Yeah, so we've got the people at the bottom. We've got the police above us, and the police are working for the representatives who are not listening to the people. Which is why we're all getting shadow banned, demonetised, not listened to in meetings closed down. They try and give us a little bit of hope. So we know in Thetford we get 15 minutes, don't we? We get 15 minutes at the Thetford Council. And the minute we ask them a challenging question, they are not happy. They wriggle. They obstificate, and as soon as that 15 minute comes up, they close the question and the debate and time down. You can't even get in at Breckland. I've been told that we can get in at county. I'm not quite sure about that. We do plan to test that, but I'm sure if we go to county and we're allowed to ask a question, we'll be closed down very quickly. But what it's all pointing to is that we are not being represented by our elected representatives, the people we put in.
Well, they're corporations as well, of course, aren't they?
And they're all working for the corporations. And it's getting back to this one that I've shown you here. And this is what people don't understand or don't comprehend. It's because they're all involved in the land, the law of the water. Okay. So those of you being through it, your legal fiction, So, Mr. Mark Petrie Taylor, when I go to court, no ma'am, my name is Mark of the family Taylor. I keep myself on the land. I don't go into the water because they have all these little tricks to get you to accept the contract and you don't know you're accepting the contract. And that means that they've trapped you in this type of law and you've got to keep yourself in that. The whole of society, our education, the televisions, the papers, are all set up to reinforce this. And this is now why there's a lot of friction at the council levels. We can all see what's going wrong. We could bring all the litany of problems, the people on the boats are homeless. Why is it not being sorted out? It's because of this. And they're running out of water. Out of money. So the aim for this evening then, in its embryonic state, is to get some of the people from Thetford to come and sit around a table. And it's going to be quite hard because people are not professional. There's supposed to be two professionals here tonight and one's let me down, so it's just me. So after the speaking part that I've got now, I wanted to hand over to the other professional and go quiet. Unfortunately, I can't do that, so you're going to have to put up with me. I'm going to have to keep talking slow for a bit longer. But the idea now is that we will invite some of our volunteers to come forward. We will sit around a table and establish a, I don't want to call it the Shadow Council, I want to call it the Thetford Sovereign Council, because we're going to stand in our sovereignty.
Yeah.
And basically we've got a small agenda that we've decided is very applicable to the town right now. And what we'll do is we'll spend a few minutes going through the agenda, listening to the problems in the town and seeing what people sitting around the table have to say about it. See if we get a few bright ideas. We will also talk about it with members of the public who are listening, so we get the public involved in the discussion and not kept out of it and only told you're on the clock for a question. I do ask that you don't go overboard though, we're all still here at 3 o'clock in the morning.
You need to chair it.
Yeah, that's for sure.
So that is the idea. Now, I don't know if this has been done before. I know Ipswich is setting one up. Bob's told me how far they are. But we've never done this before. So please, I ask you to bear with us.
Apparently there was one in Bury St Edmunds.
Right.
There is no more.
How long was that?
See, what I thought, keep me straight, I thought when you've got the word shadow in there, if you think about it in the Houses of Parliament, we have the government of the day and the cabinet, don't we?
Yeah,
and then you have a shadow cabinet. Now, we all know that the shadow cabinet are doing exactly the same as the government cabinet, and they all work for the same people. So what I'm thinking is, if people are starting off at the lower levels, a shadow, they may still be in bed. With the bad people at the same time, if that makes sense. Yeah. So that's why I thought it was a good idea not to call it a shadow, but to call it sovereign. Mm. And we'll stand in our sovereignty.
That's stronger.
And we'll stand under common law as much as we can. Mm. And we can then, depending on what comes out of our meetings, we can then take these back to the elected council and put them under pressure. And we've got various means of getting the information out to the people of Thetford and the wider community across the country to see if they want to pick this up and run with it as well. Is there any more questions on anything, Captain Sheriff?
Yeah, what's the arrangement with the room?
The arrangement with the room is?
I thought we'd all be standing in a pub and we're in a room. How did you arrange that?
Because of my sculpture arm.
No, are you paying for it?
Well, I don't want to give any secrets away on film.
He's giving him a wall of fake
20. I can't have a one-to-one face-to-face with you later on and explain what's happening.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, are you happy with it though?
Sure.
Yeah. I'm
pleasantly surprised.
I thought you were going to say to me, I don't like the carpet. I was going to say, it's a lovely lady behind you. So is anybody who's not heard that before got any questions about the L, the A and the W? And how the common law roughly works. I mean, if you've got that in your head, you'll be on the straight and narrow, and you can always go on further seminars and courses, which we'll go into in a lot more detail, which is interesting. Okay, so all I'm going to do now is ask anybody who's volunteering from Thetford to please come and sit around the table, and let's get Sean to run with it. Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Thetford Sovereign Council. Okay. And we're going to go by the agenda. We've got volunteers to sit around the table. Now the first thing we have to do is take a roll call. So basically, where's Jem, who's acting as the secretary? Can you just take the names down and who's turned up?
Yeah.
Please, Jem, yeah, you happy with that?
Yeah.
Somebody suggested that we should have some sort of oath of allegiance to the people. And I thought it was a good idea, but I think we should work on that as a body and not have it tonight, but basically have some sort of little promise that we can make on camera to the people of Thetford that we won't thieve off them. We won't join a corporation and we won't take dividends or anything like that. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that we can hand on heart say that we're working for the people and not for anything. So I think we can work on that for the next one. Right, the first thing we have to do now is elect a chair of the meeting, and a deputy of the chair can't make it. Okay, so at this point we were asked for proposals from the people around the table, a proposal for a chairman, and then we need somebody to second it, and then we go to a vote. So the idea now is, if you want to say anything, just put your hand up like that, and I'll be straight on to you. Yeah. So we don't shout across the table. Yeah. We just put our hand up. Jeff.
You chairman.
Well, you want to propose me for chairman? Okay.
I'll propose yourself as well, Mark.
If somebody's proposed it, there has to be a second.
Second.
I'll second.
Okay. Where's Jem? Proposal there by Jeff, and Rob seconded it. So it has to go to the vote now.
Table
vote. Got to go to the table vote. So if anybody wants me to be the leader.
I think you've signed yourself there.
It wasn't supposed to go like that. Really. So have you got that, Jem? Good, good. Okay, so the next thing we've got to do, which is the position I thought I was going to be in, is we have to now have a proposal for the deputy chair. So this is where it's big boots time, and don't be scared. So, anybody want to propose a deputy?
No, it's Jeff.
I'll second that.
Right, that's all right. Gemma, did you get that?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, so that now goes to the vote. Those who agree with Jeff being the deputy.
Fit for the role.
Yes.
Exactly.
Yes.
Definitely.
I might walk out.
No, that is able. We can change that later as things develop, depending on experience and we'll play it with common sense. You're happy with that?
Yeah.
Okay. The next thing on the agenda then is declarations of any disclosable pecuniary interest. Now, for those that don't know, that means that anything on the agenda that one of us could be involved in, we have to declare it now. So, for example, if we're talking about the council wasting a lot of money on a building down the road where they're putting in two wood burners, and I've got the job as Charlie the Chimney to be the wood burners in, I have to declare that that is an interest and I can't be part of the discussion. So that's just to take any other corruption out of the system, but I don't think there's any of us got any pecuniary interests on this agenda tonight, is there? No. We're all happy with that, yeah. Good. Right, at this point we'd usually have the minutes from other meetings read out and okayed. However, we haven't had any other meetings. It's the first one, so we have no confirmation of the minutes. Everybody happy with what would happen there?
Okay,
one of the main things that we're going to talk about tonight then, the next thing on the agenda is the Thetford Town allotments. So at this point we're going to have points presented about the loss of our, or the planned loss of our allotments within the town, and any suggestions or solutions on the way ahead. Now I haven't got my finger on the pulse on this one, but I am aware that Breckland are trying to take our allotments away and put a car park there.
Oh,
On which side? Because there's a...
I'm not sure, does anybody know more about this than...
Manford Road.
Exactly, yeah.
Train station, isn't it?
Yeah.
They're the only ones left in Fefford now.
No.
Well, let's tell them now, yes. Wait, does anybody, do you know what's happening, Carl?
No, I know there's something to do with the train station side of it, Manford Road.
Wait, Jack, what do you know? Do you want to tell the people what you know?
Yeah, there's a car park, disabled car parks, again, in some units, this, that and the other. But that's as far as I know. There's been hold-ups, as we found out from the meeting the other night. But it's been held up at the minute, but they're going full swing to do this, so it is happening.
When's it happening? When's it meant to be happening?
I think they've been held up. I mean, I don't know what the money situation with these guys, but planning side of things, we've got the aviation centre there involved as well. So,
does anybody in the audience know any more about this?
Well, there was a petition in the town. Right. There was a couple of men, they were to do the allotment, so I don't know who they were, a couple of months ago now, and I know I signed it. You know, they're trying to keep it, that's what I'm saying, but that's all I know at the moment.
So, what I'm aware of is that there's a plan by Breckland to move those allotments and put car parking in there, in situ to fit in with the train station. Okay, so we'll have plenty of cars, but we'll lose our allotments.
The allotments are huge. What kind of people are they expecting to arrive in Shetford in cars to use the train station?
Well, I would expect with the car park to become buildings and various other things. Yeah. I mean, I personally wouldn't trust them as far as I could throw them, but we need to find out more about that. We've got.
Would that be seen as another part of
land grabbing? Well, that's the way I feel it's going. Yeah. Nick, you gonna?
Has anybody checked how the land was given? Was it given in trust? Was it given on the common land? How far does it go back? Because the thing that we're finding in my county is that allotments are being taken away through lack of use. So if a council turns around and says, well, nobody's using them, we're going to take them back and we're going to build on them. There, in my village, there was a lot of land left in trust and the councillors are trying to steal it. But this was left for the people. So if we find out how the allotments were left, whether it was probably on a common land basis or was left into a trust for the people, they cannot break into the trust. And they'll try it, obviously, because they want to try to grab this land for their commercial enterprises. They make money out of it, don't they?
Yes.
And then it's robbing the people, but this goes back to the sovereignty of the people, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Because we're just robbed and milked, you know, for our lives, really. We've got to stop it.
Well, this is it. I would expect our town council to be asking these probing questions that you just alluded to, but as far as I'm aware, they're not doing that.
Narrative comes down, from their bosses. They're in a paid job, so that their bosses are saying, we better do this because it will earn money for the town. No, it doesn't. It earns money for their enterprises. It's always at the expense of people. Yeah.
Yeah, it's all, attaching on to the end of that, it's also, the much larger picture where they're trying to remove people's ability to sustain themselves and look after themselves away from their system that they want you tied into. Yeah. You know, they want you buying their goods from their supermarkets. They're shutting down small businesses to prevent the entrepreneurial side of human nature. Shutting down the allotments takes away the ability to look after yourself. Another thing, is how much of the council in debt? You know, are they selling off this land to create money?
Yeah.
You know, with disregard for the public.
See, these are the questions we now need to find the answers to, and then give to the people, so the people in Thetford are aware of exactly what's going on. Who we got there? Becky,
yeah? Yeah, they've got I've just found it on Facebook, they've got a Munford Road Allotment Protection Group, We've got 91 members.
Right.
And they've started a petition. We've got 1,000 signatures.
Get them all in.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
they're encouraging people to go to the council meeting last week.
Yes. Well, I think if we, we'll talk about that later, if we can get something out from this meeting on that, and that we're looking at the trust side, is it common land? And are they trying to do an assault on it without us actually knowing about it? And then we can marry that up with the 90 people on this. Can you take the lead on that?
Well, I was going to come to the point of, obviously, they're actually trying to move everyone else, because it's a well-established community, ain't it? You know, over 100 years. But their setup where they're trying to move everyone is a lot of smaller setup, basically. And it's not really looking good, to be fair. But obviously, with the Act 1939, the declaration to war, they've got to be giving us land, basically, to grow, and as we're contributing to a war now, sort of thing. And with this setup, it's going smaller. They're taking away. They're supposed to be giving. So that's another thing we need to look into. And also, if you can get your 15 signatures in within the month of putting it forward, it has to be individually handwritten letters, not all as one, because they bang it all together. Individually, 15 within that month of pushing it forward, then it's all underway by common law, basically.
Well, this is the Act of
1939.
Yeah. Is everybody aware of that?
No, you've
got 15. I mean, Mark and I know a bit about this, being in the game, sort of thing. But 15 individual signatures have to be put forward within the month of pressurising the concerns on this sort of thing. So it should be giving land, not taking it away. And they're taking away, and they're giving a lot smaller setup as it stands of what they're trying to give us, basically. Wait, so it's on the lines of this.
Just on that one then, can you get the paperwork that talks about that to us?
Oh, we'll get all this sorted. Yeah, 1939.
Once we see that paperwork, we can then start pushing it into the... We've got Rob next and then you, Jane.
I know they took the ones at London Road away, didn't they? They was quietly removed. They was there for years. Yeah, yeah. And if you look at it now, all it is just a plot of just grass with a path up the middle. Nothing.
Yeah.
They've done nothing with it whatsoever. So,
Jean?
Yeah, Mark, what I was going to say is I know two or three people that have got allotments on the Munford Road, and they've got disabilities, and they're just able to run their allotment, but it helps them mentally as well, and emotionally, though they grow their own vegetables and everything. And it really helps their life. They can't work, you know, and things like that. But the irony of it is that they want the car park for disabled people. Now, I know a few people that are going to the allotments that are partially disabled, but it really helps their life.
Well, that disabled car park is a long way from the train station up there.
I was going to say, it's something that was pointed out to me the other night at West Suffolk Council meeting. Is that I went off at the chairman and spoke about Agenda 21 and how they're following orders and so on and so on. Something that we need to keep in mind is that these councillors that are selling the land and for profit for the town and so on and so on probably aren't aware of the bigger agenda.
Yes,
right.
So that's worth considering.
Yeah.
Just let me, and then you told me.
Just on a quick note, I've been looking into. Come from a farming background, so looking into, with a new CIC we've set up, what funding is available. And just back to what you've just said, there's Norfolk County Council have a load of funding available, so does Suffolk County Council, that you can apply to for the mental health issue side for people keeping land. So we're just in the process of going through that, and there is... It's about 2.2 million that Norfolk County Council's got. So, as the sovereign council, you should be applying for some of that.
Yes.
I agree what you're saying there, but when you put your common sense head on, they are, I believe, there's 60 million in the potentially in the red. And if the government doesn't bail them out on the next tranche of funding, I would probably say that part
will
be one of the first. But we can push that though, yes.
What I can say is we were told by the lady who contacted us that you need to get this in very quickly.
Yeah, which is probably right, yeah. So, right, so that's something we need to look at.
Yeah, 100%.
And then we need to get that in at the next step that comes from me.
100%, that's done.
Tony, are you going to say something?
Do we know how much of the capacity of that particular...
I was going to ask that.
area has been taken up by people.
No, well, our other representative that was coming tonight,
right,
we thought would have given us the information on that.
Because, I mean, I've heard in the past where there's been waiting lists for these things in Thetford, so I can't see that.
More interest, the better, isn't it?
But we need to know for sure, of course.
Yeah. You can still apply as well online for allotment.
Probably all need to, don't you?
And this is.
I think we all probably know what's going on, don't we?
Yeah.
I don't know the area. Is that a car park? Is it in the middle of nowhere? Or
it's opposite the football club.
Pretty much.
And the innovation centre.
That's not really needed.
You were going to say something?
Yeah, I was just going to add to the previous comments about the cost of living crisis for everybody. We're all in it. Why are they taking land away from people when you can grow for next to nothing? So that needs to be
reaffirmed as well.
You've answered your own question.
Yeah. We're all in it and they're not. Yeah. And they don't care.
No, we know that. Nick, you were going to say something?
Yeah, it's just something from what Zach was saying about the 1939 Act. I don't know if anybody remembers or if it happened in this area, that when the soldiers were coming back from the First World War, they were all given an acre of land to grow their own food. And this has happened in Lincolnshire. And a lot of properties were given to the soldiers coming out. Now, I would say that probably if you looked into it a little bit further, going back to 1918, 1919, you might find a little nugget of information there that will allow people to grow food for themselves. And we know probably the reason why they're not allowing to grow, and it's probably not what we're going to be, what you want to grow tonight, but Mark has a particular bit of information that might help you keep hold of the allotments. Would you allow Mark to just share that with you?
It's just an idea that maybe there is a rare plant which is protected that's in that allotment, or an animal, or a butterfly, or bats, newts. I'd try anything.
On the newt question, now I know this for a fact because my brother used to work on the A1 and they had a road that was going close to a pond where there was newts, and they had to build an underpass to allow the newts to go from one pond to another, and that cost $1 million back in 1986, 1987.
I would suggest on what we've heard tonight at the minute then, Zach, if you and, because you and Barbara have done a bit on this, haven't you?
Yeah.
On the allotments.
No, I've
been in there. You see if you can work with Barbara.
You can't.
But we need to find out about that paperwork from
1913. Oh,
yeah. And if you can just find out, do a search and find out about this funding.
Yeah.
That we've got to get in quick.
Oh, CRC. Yeah.
Try and get a bit more information on that.
2.2 million, you say? 2.2 mil.
Get some information on that.
Yeah.
And we've got time then. Once we get that information, we can then get in touch with the allotment 19.
Yeah.
Have a go with them, get them on board with any information we've got. Also have a look, because people have a look if they know anything about butterflies. And then on those three points we can then go to the next council meeting and get in there on those points about the allotments and get them moving on that. You're all happy on what we said about the allotments? Okay, then that's good. The next agenda item is the planned rise in rent to the Red Line and Wetherspoon. Okay, I don't know if any of you know about this.
Yeah, I've got a clue.
I did speak a few weeks back to the manager of Wetherspoons in Thetford. Now, I was a councillor in Thetford who helped, and I gave a couple of speeches to establish the chairs outside. And everybody loves sitting outside when the weather's good at Thetford. And they've got the nice lights there and it looks great. But I knew that the Labour contingent at the time, when we voted it in, we're not happy. And Labour were totally against, for some reason, the good people of Thetford sitting out in the sun, getting a bit of vitamin D in, and having a smoke and a beer and something to eat. I couldn't get my head around it. And what I found out from Wetherspoons is that the Labour majority on the Deptford Town Council allegedly are talking about putting the rent up times three for the Red Lion, which is owned by Thetford Council. That's one of the buildings in Thetford's portfolio, and they set the rent. Now, if the rent is set three times higher than what it is now by the Labour contingent, I have on good authorities that Wetherspoons will probably pull out of the town. Now, what that means is that'll be a loss of jobs for 60 people in Thetford and Farnham. There's 60 jobs for Thetford in the area rely on Wetherspoons. Plus, it's one of the few places where the kids can go and put something on and have a decent night, because it is run from a security point of view quite well. So, has anybody got any thoughts on that? Wetherspoons.
What's the agenda behind doing that?
I'm not quite sure, but I think because they've lost it as a car park. They've lost it as a money spinner. From the corporation point of view, there's no cars parking there.
But the car park wasn't
was
charged.
Free anyway. Sorry?
Yeah, it wasn't charged, was it, the car park?
No, it wasn't charged, but I'm trying to figure out if they've got another motive for use of that car park from a point of view of making money.
Yeah.
I remember 10, 15 years ago, they was trying to make that pay, and Terry Jeremy was a big fan of making that a pay car park. Yeah. And he's Labour, isn't he?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's why.
But for some reason, they were totally against that car park
being opened for
the public and for any of the shops up there on the Shambles to use that area. There's an accommodation between the market and the shops. Everything goes, when the market's there, they have to close it or make it smaller. There's no problem there whatsoever.
Or is there another, are they thinking about a change of use for that
property
building?
Yeah.
Well, we don't know.
Or just selling it off. Mm-hmm. Who knows?
Yeah. Tony?
All I can say from personal experience has been that in myself, when that's been lit up and during the daytime and in the early evening with friends and the rest of it just adds a real ambience to that square, that area there outside the pub.
Yeah.
And I can't see many people in the town who would, like to see that go.
Yeah.
And maybe a petition of some sort would be a good idea to start.
Yeah, my point is, I don't think the people in Thetford are aware of the plan. Surely on you.
Well, if the council are in trouble, selling the allotments for money, mm-hmm. selling that building for money, where else are they going to sell off?
Probably worth a couple of
millionaires.
That's
got to be.
Yeah.
that's got to be a bigger picture to look into, isn't it? Yeah. If there any other plans of
what they want to put in there?
What they want to put in there, and what other buildings? The library.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I did. They were trying to put some of the buildings in trust.
Yeah, we need to get more information, but again, that's a question we're going to have to ask the council.
Ultimately, they're public buildings, and they cannot be sold off.
Yeah, well,
it all depends who owns them.
Tony, are you going to
show them? No,
I would suggest at the minute that what we're hearing tonight is, once the meeting's finished, we find ways and talk about ways of letting the people of Thetford know what that potential plan is for the seating area, and if that potential plan goes through, what the cost to the town will be. I think we need to advertise that so the people in Thetford can start to put pressure onto the elected council. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
So, how can you make the people of Thetford aware? I mean, what's the plan for putting all this into the front rooms of the people of Thetford? How can we get it across?
We're going to cover that later on. That'll be brilliant. Covered at the end, when we do a walk on everything, Alan. But it's a good point.
Yeah.
Has anybody else got any points on
that? Sure, there's a second subject I'm going to bring up on the last subject. Aren't the council supposed to put public notices out, notifying people what's going on?
Well, what they do is they put it out through the minutes and of the meetings.
Well, I mean, all the years I've lived in Hayes, when something major's being done, you've got notices on lampposts.
No, it's not a planning thing in that way. I know it's not like that. It's different. But because people are not turning up at the meetings and it's not getting advertised, people are not finding out what is happening.
So there's no reason to say they should do that.
No, but it's not that type of. That's a different arena. But we let the people know what's going on. Yeah, we all agree with that. Right. But the next thing on the agenda is the anti-social behaviour within the town. Has anybody got any points to say about that? On the table.
There's been a few stabbings, haven't there, in the town over the last couple of weeks. There was one the other week, a young lad. There's been some attacks of young girls, I've heard. That's on. I think the best, I'm not on Facebook, but there's the Thetford group in there, community group or something. Is anyone on Facebook? My partner's on there. There's a lot of information on there. Apparently, there's quite a lot of attacks going on.
It is a gang. Of youths, about 15 of them.
In English or
a gang of them.
I am aware that there's been a lot of incidents on White Hart Street outside the kebab shop, and I know somebody was arrested the other night, but had been let off on bail.
So they got CCTV.
I've heard that. I'm also aware that the Danish, because we've got a lot of Danish in the town at the minute, staying in the hotels. One of them had a fracker in the Green Dragon and was chased down the street and severely beaten in a really bad way. And the Danish have been told that they can't go in so many hostilities around the town, which is bad for money generation within the town. If you've got people there with money, But we point is, because of the violence in the town, they're now being told where they can't go, which is a loss of money. What there is, and it was there when I was a councillor, is the Safer Thetford Action Group, which they call the STAG. And that's where there's a lot of interested parties from the town come together with representatives from the police once a month. I think it's once a month. And they decide what the police priorities are in the town. But it's quite interesting, when I went to the council meeting last week, one of the new councillors who's on the Safer Thetford Action Group got up and was saying exactly the same thing we were saying 8 years ago. And it was quite apparent to me that nothing has moved forward in 8 years. We have what's called, the UKIP actually forced it through many years ago, the Public Space Protection Order. We've got that in the town. People aren't supposed to drink or anything like that. But that doesn't seem to get policed properly.
You haven't got the police to do it. That's the thing.
Yeah, and that's not a priority either. What I plan to do, and I invite anybody who's sitting around the table, I'll find out when the next STAG meeting is, and I suggest some of us from this table go there and apply some pressure on the police and the people sitting there. So I'll get that to you. I'll find out what the date is and let you know.
I mean. Is it true that the police have been told not even to attend if someone's robbing a shop? Yeah, if it's less than £200, then don't bother going.
This is it. We're picking this up from all around the country. The police priorities are changing. Yeah, shoplifting's going to the back of the queue if it's being looked at all. Now, we need to, I think when we go to the Safer Thetford Action Group, this is the question that we can ask the police.
Yeah, yeah.
It's the only time that the police turn up and you can ask them a question.
Right, yeah.
What the answer will be from them will be interesting. But we'll find that out. So we can get more information at that, Alan, and then we can decide then through our media avenues what we're going to do and how we educate
people. There's a viral video going around of a group of... people, it was shown to me on the site. There's just, I don't know, 10, 20, 30 people just going into a shop, helping themselves and walking out because individually they're stealing less than £200.
Yeah. But that wasn't in Thetford, though, no?
No,
but it could come to Thetford.
But it does go on. I did know somebody who worked at a little Tesco.
Yeah.
And she was saying at the time, this is a while ago, she was saying at the time, if it was like £20 worth, it'd be let them go.
Yeah.
That was back then.
Yeah.
So it's been going on a while. It's just that the amount you can steal has risen.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I know, especially...
Is it?
Especially at the Bell Hotel, we've got people coming there to visit Dad's Army and staying in the old, quaint Thetford historical town. And if they're there at the weekend, I know there's a lot of complaints about the noise, the shouting and the fighting. So, it is affecting business as well. You were going to say something, Tony?
Are these stag meetings not open, are they? So how are we going to get people to allow to attend them?
Well, I'm going to try and set up through this. If not, the other thing we've got is we've got a member of the town council here.
Yeah.
And I think we need to get a priority to get him onto the stag.
Yeah.
And then at least he can then put some information coming from us and get the questions we want answered. But what the police and the town council do, I think it might be once every quarter, they have an open meeting.
All right.
So I think it's once a month with the council and interested bodies, and I think it's once a quarter with the public.
Right.
Now that is when we then need to get there in numbers with some good questions.
Where do they hold them?
I'll find out. They change it periodically.
So if I've taken on board what you just said, it's a safer action group for Thetford, but you're not allowed to attend it.
No, it's members of the council.
Right.
It's members of the council and other interested people. Like you'll have somebody there representing the shop.
But the council somebody don't tell the people what's going on.
This is why we're saying we've got to start applying the pressure from the bottom up.
Right.
And this is what this is all about. Yeah. At least we're waking ourselves up. But,
we've been prepared, haven't we?
Nothing ever goes anywhere.
No.
But this is the shocking thing. But the more people we start getting around this table, if we can get 18 sitting here
yeah.
and everybody taking the lead on something and firing on a bit of information and taking a subject and getting that information, that is where eventually...
We'll start, that's
it. And then we have our avenues of getting out the information we've found and putting the pressure on.
Yeah.
From little acorns. Is there any other comments on the anti-social behaviour within the town? Stay safe out there.
I was just sort of thinking, not that it's going to be staged or anything, but then this could do with the shutting down the Westerns by putting that out there because everyone's all drunk and everything, aren't they?
No, not social behaviour.
Do you know what I mean? Like going along those lines of shutting Westerns down.
No, they won't shut Westerns down, not if we can help. Right, what have we got next on the agenda? Public comments for future discussion. Is there anything, especially the people from Thetford who are here, is there anything that you want us around the table to look at, to come forward at the next meeting, get something on the agenda and discuss it? Is there anybody in the audience first got any points that they want looked at?
As the Sovereign Council, are you looking to fundraise to be able to fund projects?
Yeah. I would say in the future that's something we've got to do. I personally don't pay council tax. I'm fed up with me money being wasted. However, I would like to put my money into a local pot trust where the money that we give goes to the benefit of
the people affected, not war and terrorism.
It has to be
now. Or paying big pensions and paying for a big figure salary of the CIO.
I'm up for putting that in.
But I think that's something we're going to have to look at, and then as money is generated, we'll be able to do things that way. However, at the minute... The
reason I say is because I've got recently set up a CIC, and I'm getting all sorts of information chucked my direction about funding pots that are available that you could easily mould, if I use that as a word, certain aspects of what you're doing. And number one on the agenda, for instance, there is definitely pots of money out there for that. I've sent you the link.
Yeah, 100%.
And there is other pots out there for antisocial behaviour and different things which you could bring in to spend that money on projects.
Mike, can I give you my personal feeling on that as an ex-councillor? There's pots of money everywhere at the higher levels of council, controlled by people who are getting paid lots of money to control them. That money is coming out of our taxes, which we can't afford to spend.
I fully understand that, but they're going to spend it anyway, so you might as well have it.
If you can get hold of it, you mean.
Oh, you can get hold of it.
Well, yeah. Well, it definitely needs to happen then, doesn't it? Yeah.
I can see where you're going. I mean, yeah. But at the same time, if the county council is in the red, and if they're saying that the government doesn't bail them out on the next round of funding...
If they are in the red.
If they are in the red.
No, not if they are in the red. If the government doesn't bail them out. Yeah. If.
Well, my point of view is knowing what's going on, the government hasn't got any money. So how are the government going to get money to fund a council that is, look at Birmingham, to fund a council that is bankrupt? Now what they're going to do is they're going to put my council tax up that I'm not paying, and they're going to put my taxes up. Now what I'm saying is, if we keep bidding for these pots of money, my personal point of view for the future is we should have our own pot of money.
Agreed.
That we give out rather than getting these bids in. That's my personal point of view. Tony?
I don't know if anybody's aware, but the government's planning to stop the cold weather payments for most pensioners.
Really?
I mean, we all...
Well, the gas prices and they go up.
Well, we all, you know, we all know, I take it, you know, most people in this room probably must know that the money has run out, you know it's... but yeah, if we can get some quick funding now before it finishes, especially on the likes of the allotments.
Yeah, definitely.
But I would say in the medium to long term that funding will probably just, would you agree with me there?
I agree. Yeah.
Which leaves a nasty taste in my when I'm putting funding in for something Bob's paid for and he's not happy.
It's just a great thing to spend their money, irrespective to where it's come from.
Yeah.
Otherwise they're spending
it. Yeah, the gentleman in the black.
Green. Public comments for future discussion. The reason I'm here fundamentally is this climate emergency absurdity. We can't buy coal for the first time. I'm 60 years old. For the first time, we can't buy coal from our local merchants. I've written letters to Suffolk Council, West Suffolk Council. I'm now writing a letter to the Police Commissioner, Tim Passmore. Obviously, I'm in Suffolk, just over the border. I think this is the most dangerous thing to this country and to all of us in this room right now, is this carbon zero thing. As far as I'm concerned, it's utter nonsense.
Yes, totally.
And that's why I'm really here.
What was their reason?
I said, obviously, this is to do with, you think carbon dioxide is a toxin to us. He said that it wasn't a decision by the... local council, he said it was a government, central government directive. And in our case for coal, it was because of particulates in the air to keep the dirty air of Suffolk clean. I've lived in London, Istanbul, and Kuala Lumpur. I can assure you, the air in.
The only data they get is from.
But that's a future discussion. Yeah. I think this is. Number one, people don't understand. They think that David Attenborough is telling the truth. He's not. He's lying. He's a snake oil salesman. And unfortunately, you have from the Bank of International Settlements down to the UN, everybody is touting this idea. It's not true. And I don't know how you're going to get, but that it has to be addressed. It's going to kill people.
So with the carbon, I want to get rid of them.
Yes.
Does anybody else, I'll get you into it, anybody else who wouldn't want to say anything about what the gentleman has said?
Well, we're all in agreement, aren't we?
Yeah.
Just put a ban on coal. They've also put a ban on wood burners and wood.
No, they haven't.
They haven't yet, but they're threatening.
I still love them. They haven't.
No.
Chairman, can I just add that I went to see my local coal merchant in Barn. I've also written to the Coal Federation, to Wilma Brooks, and she's written back to me. They're all under the pressure. I mean, none of them can do anything because the government have made it illegal to sell what I call proper coal.
Mm-hmm.
And they won't stop a coal.
Oh no.
And I just, we must make this a public discussion.
No, I'm with you there, yeah. Do you want to go to... Right, Nicky, do you want to come and bring it back in?
Right. Dare I say agenda 21?
Yes, I'm going to bring that up now, yeah.
Right, well, I've got a piece of information here through, it's West Lindsay District Council on their government website, and it's local agenda 21. And it reads, the principle of local agenda 21 is a furthering of agenda 21 process agreed at the United Nations Conference on Environment and Development, the Rio Earth Summit held in 1992, the local Agenda 21 process is endorsed by the UK government. That's on their website. So yeah. The council deny that it is, it's, I can send you that, it's not a problem.
Yeah, I'll be stabbed that. I was on a registry before I came in here.
Oh, you read it? All right, sorry. Read it again.
I'm a member of Together. I was at the AGM on Friday, last Friday, and the event, and we voted to have a campaign, no to net zero. Yes. So I would suggest that they need members. The more of us that there are, the more problems we're going to be a right thorn in the side of these bastards, and that's what I suggest we do.
Okay,
well,
you saw the social? Yeah. After Bob.
Yeah. On the, off the back of that, that's exactly what we've been trying to do over at West Suffolk Council. After, I think I was next in line to speak about that exact thing before it exploded. But I honestly think that the, yeah, especially as this is being filmed and put out on alternative media, what we need to do now is put facts in there that it is. The whole thing's a hoax, and the whole thing is—it's just a new business model that they're building. By going out into the social media and alternative media platforms, it is just about turning public opinion,
yes.
And just exposing these people for exactly what they are. And like you say, calling the side. Look what happened on Tuesday. It was such a thorn in the side that the council left the building, or left the room.
I'm just going to get these two and I want to see what we
thought. Back to the gentleman, Suffolk climate bloody emergency thing. For air quality out of the whole of West Suffolk, Great Barton Junction is the only place they test for this.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's some so-called emergency that's going on.
Well, I didn't look into that.
Go on.
Mr. Gallin,
Ian Gallin,
the CEO of Suffolk Council, used that as an example of making the air in Suffolk better.
Right, okay.
And that was his only example, wasn't it? That they'd moved the pedestrian crossing from point A to point B to improve particulate matter, right? But this crossing, just from local knowledge, used to be near a dangerous junction.
Yeah, it was, yeah.
Right? They didn't move it for better air quality. They moved it because it was in a dangerous bloody spot. And yet he used that as an example of Suffolk County Council doing good.
Going back to the gentleman about the coal, who has ever heard of the Bank of International Settlements?
Yeah.
This has got to be brought up from day one. Yeah. They're the ones in control, but no one's ever heard of them.
I agree with what everybody has said here tonight. My point is, arguing with the man on the street all the time, as a man who used to do strange things in the military, knowledge is power. Now, what is the one bit of knowledge and information that we've got about this net zero is where we can get them is we ask them how much carbon dioxide is in the atmosphere.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, it's working. We're starting to see it on alternative media.
Yeah.
Nobody who's pushing, because as we went through on the board before, our representatives are working for the corporations and the people who are above the corporations, so they're being fed the Agenda 21, the Agenda 30 line. Mm. For example, after we'd had our meetings in Thetford, the Conservatives in Norfolk on the front page of the EDP stated that they were dropping all green initiatives. and a nice picture of Thetford who's on page two applying the pressure. However, it's like you said about the one you said, Nick, when you go into the fine detail of Norfolk County Council, somewhere on page 27 they are still promising to adhere to Agenda 30 and sustainability. So all that means is they've parked it and they're going to come back. Yeah. Now, the ordinary councillors, the majority of them, I would say, are ignorant.
Yeah.
I would say the officers who are being paid yeah. lots of money and provide the continuity
yeah.
when the representatives move, yeah. they're the ones who are the guardians mm. of this thing in the detail
yeah.
of this still going to put us through sustainability. I think we have to get out to the public that it is 0.04, so it's not even half
a gram.
Yeah. Now, they don't know that. Also, that it's gone up from 0.03, and if it goes to 0.02,
we're in trouble.
Mm-hmm. You know, I would say we've got to get out to the public. Can I just say one thing?
And the other most important thing is that the human's contribution is 3% of 0.04. That is what they're pushing, that we are obviously increasing the CO2, and that's what we've got.
I would say to you, the hook for the public is keep it simple.
Yeah.
You know, just the first big figures.
Yeah.
And explain that if it goes down to the two, we're in trouble.
But most children, you see, are educated and told that we are the problem. Yes. And that's, I think, what we've got to get over to yes. the public. Yeah. They've got to see that it's not us that's raising yes. the temperature.
But the only way we can do that is through re-education.
Yes.
Like people like us, not listening to the controlled narrative, meeting like this, and getting out the proper information that we find out. So I would say that the next time we meet like this, we'll have a planned initiative on what we're going to do in the town to combat the net zero misinformation. Would we agree with that?
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
Just quickly, would you like to be quite in touch with somebody with expertise in this? Because I have a friend who has been doing some interviews on climate change.
Yes, and what we'll do is I'll try and through the council, yeah. if they'll let us try and get a presentation.
Yeah, I mean, we'll work it that way. Supply information, yeah. and certainly.
Would he do a presentation?
He would speak to you personally. He probably would do a presentation. I think he would.
Yeah. Okay, so thanks for that from the public. Let's have a look.
You've got one hand up.
Sorry.
I'm from Tisden Giles, all right. And in the area, they were going to have, they have proposed a solar farm, right? Massive solar farm, right? Something like, what's it, 800 acres, well, not 800, whatever it is, but it's massive. Right? So other people are going there and they're being convinced that this is a great idea. I actually went down there and the first thing I asked was, exactly the question you asked. What's the issue? What is it? You were talking about green. What is the problem? And everyone said, oh, it's carbon dioxide.
Yeah.
So I then said, okay, tell me, what is the amount of carbon dioxide that we have got, and where do we want to reduce it to? Don't know. I've been marketing. I don't know. So I said, well, take a guess.
Yeah.
Oh, well, it's bad, isn't it? It's 50%. So I was, you know, I made, okay, maybe it wasn't the best thing, but I kind of like said, well, okay, well, let's, you know, raise my voice and got people to understand that it was only 0.04%. And they're shocked, right? They're, you know, people are shocked. But the problem is, you've got to have lots of people keep going in and saying yeah. that, because it's a whole day event, right?
Yeah.
And you can't, you know, it's difficult to be there for the whole day.
Well, we'll next time we have a meeting here, we'll of this council, we'll have an initiative, I would say, that we can launch in Thetford. You know, we've got a lot of good ideas, people around the table, and some who are not here, and we'll come up with a good initiative and we'll launch it in the town. We'll come up with something big, even me, yeah. Get in there.
So, the CEO that you mentioned, Ian Gallen, one 193.333. So these are the type of figures that are pushing this information out to us as the mainstream.
Yeah, I would.
It's important that people check into sort of
while they're getting paid that,
it's unbelievable. Going to change their minds. People homeless on the streets.
What they need is public pressure to expose them.
I would always say to the public, when you look at especially the higher levels of council, start to look at the CEOs and the chairman of these things they call place and stuff like that, and find out what money they're being paid.
Probably six figures.
When you find out what money they're being paid. And, you know, for example, when we found out that Birmingham Council went bankrupt, the councillors are still getting paid a wage, and all the officers are still getting paid their high salaries. So, you know, we have got to wake the public up. This is one way of doing it. We're doing it now. And, you know, we've got to wake the public up.
And the same as the charity shops being set for this book, charity shop after charity shop. On is running on charities, they're on double figures, hundreds of thousands.
At least.
So, you give a pound to a charity shop, 90p goes to the
CEO.
But people don't know that.
As we know, some of the bigger charities are just money laundering.
Red Cross
programs.
We'll come up with an issue.
I think the thing is, like you say about getting information out to the public, is that each and every one of us in this room has to stand up and speak about it and not be bashful. I mean, I'm quite a shy character. But that's where people need to be. If you've got the knowledge, you do have to just grow up there and stand in the town and speak it.
Well, I think we can do that. You know, we're coming up with lots of initiatives at the minute. You know, we can do the Net Zero initiative. We can do that to explain to people about our charity shops initiative, and we can say how much the CEOs are. So there's a lot we can do. Now we've got some good ideas from ourselves and from the public. We can move on with that at the next meeting. next thing on the agenda is community engagement. How are we actually going to get out what we've discussed in here to the public? So how are we going to get out to the public about what we've discussed about tonight? Okay. We can get some minutes out, and I've got a few little ideas on paperwork to come on explaining what's going on here tonight and giving it out to the people. We've also got, we're being filmed tonight by LSB Film Productions, so the meeting will go out all over YouTube, and we can push that and pass that on through everybody's social media. And we also know that this will be picked up by Richard Bowles. So I think a lot of this will go out by Richard Bowles. So we will be getting engagement with the community, not just in Thetford, but far afield, which is good.
You've got four forums, Thetford forums on Facebook.
Yeah.
You've got two Thetford forums, one community forum, and one rejects forum.
Yeah, but
people that say things.
I'd say there's a couple of forums we'll
that'll go out through there.
No, it's not just that. I just want to say to everybody in the room, just to finish off, we're talking about, in effect, platforms. I don't know if you've noticed, like me, I'm not being able to send a lot of the stuff out on WhatsApp at the minute. They're blocking me. Everybody's telling me that Telegram can be taken down any minute. I just want Rob to say a couple of words about what he's invented and what he's got for us there, and if we can all get on it, we know that because he runs his own servers, we won't get taken down. So I'd just like to Rob to explain what he's done for those who don't know. Nothing good.
Hi, I'm Rob. A few months back, I created a social network site. It's called Horizon. So it's pretty much like Facebook. You've got private messaging on there, you've got your news feed, you've got groups, pages, events,
photos, videos, upload audio, there's upload video. It's all highly encrypted, 256-bit ASE encryption. I've done IT for over 30 years, quite a lot of experience in it. The server is run at my house, it's my own server, it's built at my house, it's all encrypted. The SSH certificate is all distributed from the server itself, so nothing goes through any third-party companies. And I can pretty much run the social network site from a field with a generator and a 4G router. So that's pretty much it. It's called Horizon.social. So it's not in no app store. There's no app. You'll have to go via URL, and then you can save it to thing on your home screen. I'll show you.
May I ask how many people in this room are on it? I am. How many people in this room are on it? Is that it?
No, don't be too hard on them, they might not come
back. No, I'm not being hard.
Hence the announcement.
The thing is, well, after Richard Vokes, you interviewed you, didn't he?
Yeah.
It was bombarded, and your home servers nearly blew up, didn't they?
Yeah, that's pretty much. We had like 200 sign-ups in 5 minutes, which you can imagine is a lot of work for the database. It was a small server at the time. We're on a second server now. People have donated and funded, bless them, and we're now on a much bigger server that will host possibly easy 100,000 people.
So. I think you need to have a paper copy of what we do it as a newsletter, because you're all dependent on having access to the internet, and you may not have that unless you go into the system. So I do like a newsletter and like stick it in light paper and you hand them out, or put them up on like the parish notice board or something like that. But don't be dependent on the internet.
I know somebody in the town who might be planning something called the TCP, the Thomas Paine Crisis Pamphlet, and that'll be the newsletter.
What's that site called again, please?
It's called Horizon.social.
All in one?
Yeah, all in one. That's a URL, yeah. Horizon.social.
The rising.
Oh, Horizon. The rising, as in the rising sun.
Oh, the rising. Yes,
okay. The name The Rising come from, because if you look at the logo, it's a giraffe. I lost my mum 10 years ago. She was a big, giraffe was her favourite animal. Big part of my life, so I include her in my projects.
Lovely.
So that's where the giraffe come from for the logo, and with the giraffe, that's where the rising comes from. So we're rising our head above the bullshit, and we'll see what's going on. Sorry.
Good analogy.
So that's.
Was there another hand up over there that I missed? Well, what I would say to you all, I think tomorrow when we get 10 minutes, I commend that everybody gets onto the rise and gets a footfall on that. Because I tell you what, if some of the doom and gloom that I hear are going to take everything down, we'll also be able to communicate on that. So let's get on it.
Yeah, because it's a normal web URL at the moment, but if things go, we can also put it on the Tor network, so it'd be highly encrypted, and then you'll need a Tor browser to access it. So.
What's a server?
A server is, it's basically just a PC that's on all the time, and it's more powerful. I mean, the current server.
So it's a box?
It's a big box, yeah. Current server's got 96 gig of RAM, 12 processors.
Could you give me for example, a Facebook or an Amazon server? These are like huge corporate.
Yeah, well, Facebook or something like that, they have data centers, so they have thousands of these servers. Okay. That are all connected. You could be connected to server one, your friend in the same room could be connected to server two. So it's just a way to, it's called the CDN network, Central Delivery Network. But ours at Horizon is just one big server.
But what you're saying is, with more members, you mean, more people subscribing, you're going to have to have more money to get
it. It will increase, yeah, and then it'll be two servers, four servers that will do the work together.
Yes,
yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
And we can get funding for that as we make it bigger.
Yeah.
There's advertisement space as well, so anyone who's got a local business, you can advertise on there. From the rates are from £5 a week, so it's quite reasonable. It's getting 80,000 plus hits a week.
Great. So, very good. Fantastic.
Would there be a local paper of yours that might preface?
sign anything that local, this has started in
the
any
local
way,
papers,
shape,
the local papers all control opposition.
Yeah, there's nothing, they wouldn't write anything at all.
No, all controlled by bad people.
I know.
Following on from that, why don't you start your own then?
No, that's what I said. We've got this thing called the TCP. For those who don't know, the crisis pamphlet is what Thomas Paine used to write during the Revolutionary War, and that imbued the Americans to be the most professional army in the world at the time. It's just the British. That's how they got their independence.
I know, just out of interest, UK Column was saying that obviously there's this hard hit on social media and trying to get rid of, obviously, the platforms, the independent platforms.
Yes.
And they were saying, I didn't realise this, but they started off with the paper originally.
They started off with an A4 sheet.
Exactly. So they said that they may even have to go back to that. So it's, all I was saying is that maybe it's a way of linking up with people like that
A4 sheet's an excellent idea.
At those times.
Well, that's it.
When it's a possibility of having to go back to paper.
But, you know, but what I'm saying is if we get it out on paper,
yeah,
which we're working on,
yeah,
if we get it out on the local LFB site,
yes,
which is going international,
yeah,
we've got Bulgy.
Fantastic.
And then if everybody starts sharing it, whatever, that's why my phone is continuously pinging, because I've got about 10,000 mates.
Yes.
And you just get it everywhere. Okay, what we're going to do now is we're going to close the meet, but I'd like to thank you all for coming. I think what we've got out of it tonight is a bit of education, and we need to educate the people who don't know what's going on, and we've all got to do that in whatever way we can, with whatever tool we can. Well, thanks for coming, and we'll see you again in the next one.
Thank you
very much.